Hi there, it's Marilda. The megalithic civilization of the Neolithic era were matriarchal, right? But even today, dozens of communities around the world are still matriarchal. Welcome to The Princess Left the Tower. Please subscribe and hit the notification bell so you won't miss any exciting facts about matriarchy. Today, I'm going to talk about the Minangkabau of Sumatra. Sumatra is an Indonesian island. In the western part of Sumatra live the Minangkabau, about 4 million people, the most significant modern matrilineal community. Their organization is a pacifist. This is the primary characteristic of matriarchal societies in the past as well as in the present. Their value is the caring for the community's needs. Instead of the principle of divine justice, sacrifices, and strict gender rules, which are typical of the patriarchal society. The value of care and honoring of the nature cycles descend from female ancestors, who are the ancient deities. Matriarchy among the Minangkabau is not the denial of patriarchy, meant as the opposing domination of one sex over the other, okay? But it balances feminine and masculine roles, and this is another characteristic of the matriarchal communities. A fascinating characteristic of the Minangkabau is that they have part-time husbands. How cool is that? I know that you secretly want that too. It works this way. The bride lives in their mother's village. Here, the organization and the care of children is done by women and men together. But these men are the bride's brothers, uncles, or grandparents. So, men from the mother's family. Husbands live in their mother's village. There, they look after nephew or work in the fields or do other activities. And here is the cool stuff. They visit their wives in the evening and then they go back to their mother's village in the morning for breakfast. Cool. As a result of this part-time relationship, children are cared for by their mother and their maternal relatives. So it doesn't really matter who the father is. What counts is the social collective fatherhood. The marriage of a person of clan A with a person from clan B, for instance, is often not isolated, but is a part of a series of relationships. In the end, the members of the clans are all relatives. Each person has his genes in the other clans' acquaintances and is interested in helping them. This system leads to a solid peace. Awesome. Besides, there are also collective marriages and marital relationships based on visit. As a result, there is a huge sexual freedom for all women. Inheritance. Children live in their mother's village, take her name, and inherit her material possessions. Private property is almost unknown. Lands and animals belong to the clan. And there is not an exchange economy, but a gift economy. This is interesting. What is it? When people exchange goods, they look at the value of goods and want to satisfy a personal needs. In the gift economy, on the other hand, there is a giving. So the people don't look at the value of things, of goods, but want to satisfy other people's needs. The exchange interrupts the relationship. I give you something and you provide me with something else. That's it. The gift is different because it must be returned sooner or later, so the relationship continues. Moreover, they don't consider the gift in terms of economic value. So the gift can be smaller or bigger depending on the circumstances. For instance, a clan has a favorable harvest and can give more. Next time it will give less. So the system works as a social rebalancing and the wealth is better distributed. Politics. Matriarchal clans rule, that's not the right word, make decisions through assemblies and consensus. Each family sends its delegates, women or men, to the assembly. There they talk about something. If there is no agreement, the delegates come back to consulting the people they are representing. And here is an interesting fact. The misconception that matriarchy never existed was due to the presence of men in these assemblies. Some anthropologists mistook them as leaders, but they were only delegates of women. Another characteristic of the Minangkabau is a particular belief in death. After death, they say, people are reborn within the clan. A child does not remember, but once it was an uncle or a grandmother. This idea comes from observing the plant cycles. Plants die in autumn, but their seeds rest in winter until spring, when they sprout and are reborn the same as before. They think the same happens to humans. And this is why in ancient times, people were buried in fetal position. They were resting and waiting to be reborn in the clan. The seasonal cycles, the stars which disappear in the morning to return the following evening, or the sun which dies and then shines again, or the female menstrual cycle itself. All these elements are the sources of the values and beliefs of the matriarchal communities. And they all lead to one idea, the idea of a great mother who cares, nourishes and reassures all human beings, women and men. Fairy tales. Minangkabau fairy tales are little known outside the community as there are few translations. They are part of ancient oral traditions, often sung, rarely written. The fairy tales are all about women, of course, and specifically about mothers. A famous fairy tale is the one of Malin Kundan. He was a sailor from a poor family, and he decided to travel in search of fortunes. He became rich and married a princess from a faraway country. But when he returned home, he refused to recognize his old mother because he was ashamed of his humble origin, and for that reason he was cursed. When he sailed again, a storm broke out and he was turned into stone together with his ship. And the stone is still there. It is located at Air Manis Beach and is known by the locals with the name of Batu Malin Kundan. So if you ever go to Sumatra, go visit it. That's all for now. Stay tuned and I will see you in the next video. Ciao!